The next item of business is a member's business debate on motion 3637 in the name of Mike Rumbles on Blackhillock to Kintore transmission line. This debate will be concluded without any questions being put, and I would ask those who wish to speak in the debate to press the request to speak buttons now, please. And I call on Mike Rumbles to open the debate. Around 7 minutes, please, Mr. Rumbles.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Well, following a very contentious debate this afternoon, we now have what I hope will be a very consensual one, and that's maybe why it's not so popular in the Chamber. Could I start by thanking my Liberal Democrat colleagues for allowing me to take only the second members' debate this year, which has been allocated by the Business Bureau to the Liberal Democrats. We only get three debates a year, and I do appreciate the fact that colleagues have recognised the importance of this debate to the people of the northeast of the country. I'd also like to thank parliamentary colleagues from across the chamber who have indicated their support for my motion, which we're debating tonight. I particularly wanted to raise the issue of Scottish and Southern Energy's proposed Blackhillock to Kintore transmission line, which would cause, if implemented in the way they were planning, so much environmental damage to Aberdeenshire's beautiful and unique landscape, especially around Benachie. There are several Aberdeenshire residents in the public gallery today who would have been badly affected by this proposal had it gone ahead in its proposed form, not least from enterprises such as Inch Airfield, which lay directly in the path of these proposed huge 165-foot pylons. I'm using the past tense to describe this problem because no sooner had the Business Bureau programmed this debate then I received an email from Scottish and Southern Energy informing me that the National Grid had told SSE, quote, not to proceed, unquote, with this proposal. That was very welcome news, to say the least. But there was a word of warning here, as it also said that these decisions by the National Grid are reviewed annually, and there is a possibility that these plans could come back at some future date. That's why we're proceeding with this debate. There is a real concern that although this grid connection with its threat of huge pylons surrounding Benachie is not now proceeding, the National Grid could, as I say, in future years change its mind. That's why I'm focusing on suggesting simply a one-word alteration, one-word change in Scottish planning policy, which would, if implemented, undoubtedly improve the environment around our wonderful landscapes in Scotland. The current Scottish planning policy states that consideration should be given to underground grid connections where possible. It would be immensely helpful, Minister, if that word consideration could possibly be replaced by the word preference. Now, the current word consideration gives companies an awful lot of wriggle room. If consideration was replaced by preference, then companies would have clarity over what was expected of them. I know the Minister is aware of the unanimous vote by all parties in the Welsh Assembly on the 18th of January, which said, and I quote again, there should be a preference for underground cables or alternatives rather than electricity pylons in any new or current developments in Wales by the National Grid. I think and I hope that the Minister will agree with me that this is a very reasonable position to take, especially as technology has moved on tremendously in recent years. New technology already used elsewhere in Europe, based on high voltage DC transmission, now makes the act of burying cables a feasible option when it wasn't so much before. It's a more efficient way of carrying the variable power from our renewable energy sources. I believe, and I hope you'll agree, that it's important to stress that I'm not asking for the undergrounding of all electricity cables on the national grid. I'm not doing that. That would be unreasonable and unrealistic. What I am asking for is for the Minister to respond at the end of the debate to say that he will indeed examine the possibility of this one-word change to Scottish planning policy. I'm not asking for a decision today. I'm just hoping that he'll be responsive enough to say that he's going to look at this. I'm sure the Minister will agree that there aren't many debates like this where he's asked just to really examine a one-word change in Scottish planning policy, but there we are. I certainly believe that this is not a party political issue. It's an issue where we can all rally around for the sake of the communities that we represent and for the protection of our wonderful Scottish landscape. If this can be agreed on an all-party basis in Wales, then I'm sure that we should indeed be able to agree it on an all-party basis here in Scotland too. Thank you very much.
That was very succinct, Mr. Rumbles. You got everything said, well done. Caught me unawares, I now move to the open debate. And I call Richard Lochhead to be followed by Alexander Burnett. Speeches around 4 minutes, please.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Can I begin, as is customary, by congratulating Mike Rumbles on securing this debate? And it's not often that tabling a motion has such immediate impact with the cancellation of a major infrastructure project. So I congratulate him on his influence. The influence of his pen, or whether it was coincidence, but here we are in changed circumstances having this debate. But nevertheless, some of the key points that Mike Rumbles makes do deserve the attention of the Parliament and of ministers as well. I'm primarily speaking, of course, as the MSP for Moray, because the Blackhillock part of the motion is next to Keith in my own constituency of Moray. And had this particular development gone ahead, it would, of course, led to the marching through the Moray countryside of rather large pylons. And no doubt that would have led to a lot of concern locally had that gone ahead. In fact, I visited the Blackhillock substation just 3 or 4 weeks ago, and I had a briefing from SSE on the huge investment taking place there at the moment to rebuild it and expand it, and the existing substation has been dwarfed by this massive complex that's now being completed there to cope with the massive renewable energy potential from the north of Scotland, which of course has to move down to the main centres of population. I was taken outside the building and I asked what size will the pylons be of the new corridor that's being proposed if it goes ahead, and I was shown the biggest pylon in the area and told that the new pylons would be as big as that under the new development. So at that point, of course, I thought to myself, this is going to be quite a big issue in Moray if this corridor goes ahead. I just want to raise a couple of quick points. Firstly, the presence of the Blackhillock substation, which I'm told is one of the biggest, if not the second biggest, substation in the whole of Europe now that's been built at Keith in Moray, means that effectively in the future it will be a magnet for many more developments coming into the area. And because we now have the Blackhillock substation, it means any infrastructure that's going to be built will no doubt head towards the substation as it makes its way further south to Kintore or elsewhere in the future. Already some significant developments are taking place that are leading to infrastructure being put in place from the Caithness route coming down to Moray, also from the Beatrice offshore wind project, which is substantial, coming undersea, landing at Port Gordon and coming to Blackhillock before the electricity is then taken south. The Dornell wind farm also is potentially being extended. That will lead to even more electricity coming to the substation from that new wind development near Dufton. So that means that Moray potentially is going to host a lot more developments in the future. And I asked the Minister, in light of the concerns raised by Mike Rumbles, which are pertinent to all of our areas that are affected by these developments in terms of the role of underground cabling and other factors, how we can ensure they're properly taken into account and addressed. Because I know my constituents at the moment with existing developments, such as the Dornwell wind farm, those constituents living in the Dufton and Dromure areas, some of those who are directly affected by the new infrastructure, overground infrastructure, are very, very concerned about the impact on the scenery, on their own properties, and visual impact for their own areas. So we have to look at that. And I also just want to make the point about the community benefit. Community benefit has traditionally been seen as something that should be delivered by the generators, and where the actual energy developments are taking place as opposed to the infrastructure. But now we have a particular area of Scotland that's going to be subjected potentially to a lot more infrastructure as opposed to just energy developments themselves. How can community benefit be taken into account for those communities and not just those that live near wind developments or other renewable energy developments? So I think all these issues have to be looked at in more detail for the future. And I thank Mike Rumbles for raising those issues today, and I hope the Minister is able to reflect on some of the issues raised in this important debate.
I call Alexander Burnett to be followed by Rhoda Grant.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. And can I first refer to my register of interest and in particular my involvement in renewable energy. I'm also particularly pleased to have co-sponsored the motion today and like to thank Mike Rumbles for the opportunity to speak in support of protecting one of our most valued natural assets in Aberdeenshire, namely Benahee. As my wife was born in the foothills, namely Inch Hospital, and brought up at Pittodrie House, I have to declare a further personal interest in seeing its protection. So little did I know, as we ascended the snowy summit the other weekend, in what was probably inappropriate footwear given the icy conditions and a seven-year-old in tow, that the threat of the pylons was about to subside, and some may think have rendered this debate redundant. But I need to stress that this is far from the case, and the issues that arose during this matter are still very much alive and need addressing. Now, the obvious issues, such as landscape impact and the impact on businesses, is clear for all to see, no less than that on Inch Airfield, already mentioned, and represented by my constituents Ken Wood and David Sadler. Now, this is an airfield whose operation would have come under serious doubt if the pylons had gone up with a need for a 3-kilometre exclusion zone. And I'm afraid, Deputy Presiding Officer, that this was only one case of the many that got in touch. So whilst the publication of a new National Grid's Networks Options Assessment is good news, we could have a different answer in a new NOAA report next year, and that is simply not good enough. So surely, with the investment jobs and concerns of constituents all on the line, there should be more certainty and transparency to such a process. Or even better, the process should allow better alternative solutions to be considered. So these alternatives are not new and come in the form of transmission by direct current, which allows the burying of cabling, a technique already working well for HVDC cables in the rest of the UK and wider Europe. It enables less network losses, resilience against weather, has less impact on the natural environment, and is considered better for renewable energy production. In the late 1970s, we used to bury large gas pipes with short lifespans for gas transmission. So why is it unacceptable to ask that smaller cables with unlimited lifespans have the same treatment? To speak more broadly about transmissions, it is also clear that we are falling behind in our ability to keep pace with the rest of the world. China, in 2010, introduced ultra-high voltage direct currents, a step up from HDVC, and recent examples carry 20 times the capacity of Bewley Denny, and recent contracts would see the equivalent of 3 Blackhillock projects travelling from Edinburgh to Istanbul. So we are literally miles behind international transmission companies. So to conclude, I would hope that whilst the threat of Benahi may have gone for now, the wider questions remain and require further investigation, not just to protect our landscapes, but also deliver our energy needs as efficiently as possible. Thank you.
I call on Rhoda Grant to be followed by Liam Kerr.
Can I also congratulate Mike Rumbles on securing this debate and indeed the success of the campaign that the motion relates to. That said, it's good to have the wider debate on the issue, although this appears to have been solved for the meantime. There's agreement that to underground the line around Benahi, but there will be other areas, of course, that might require similar consideration and indeed of power lines that haven't yet that aren't yet in planning. But let's be clear that each site needs to be considered on its own merit, as undergrounding is not always a panacea. It has its own risks. While it might be aesthetically pleasing, it might not be environmentally sound, it might disturb natural heritage, and you can't, because you can't underground a cable without some serious disruption to the land. And it's not just the cable that needs to be undergrounded, it's the insulation, and that requires a reasonably wide trench. So if there are sensitive habitats in the area, it could be damaged or destroyed. Different soil types shouldn't be disturbed because of carbon release and therefore might not be suitable for undergrounding either. And the same with areas where there's archaeology that could be easily damaged. And where those situations arise, it might be much better to put the cable overground where it can be removed if different technologies come forward with a better solution. And cost also needs to be considered because we all pay for distribution networks in our electricity bills, and those of us here tonight may be able to afford that, but a lot of our constituents live in fuel poverty and can't afford the additional cost. Therefore, we must consider each case on its own merit and make sure that the solution that's found is sustainable both financially, aesthetically and environmentally. Therefore, preference might not be a better balance to consideration as is in the current planning guidelines. However, it's clear that undergrounding is not even being considered unless there's a public outcry at the moment, and therefore the balance and guidance is not right at the minute, and it does need review to make sure that the right vehicle for transmission is put in place at any one time. If I may, Presiding Officer, maybe push the boundaries of the debate a little and look at the costs of transmission cabling as well. And myself and others have been pushing for interconnectors from the Northern and Western Isles to the mainland for some time, but delays have led to increasing prices. I now understand that underwater cables may need to be buried as well, so it's not a preference when underwater is a, it looks like it may become a requirement. In some areas, this is sensible where trawling and dredging could disturb the cable, but where there's no risk of disturbance, surely it's less damaging to anchor it to the seabed, because burying it would displace large areas of the seabed and indeed the natural habitat that it provides, because we know very little about the conditions at depth, and therefore it would be precautionary. We should be precautionary about what we do there. Therefore, I would ask that those proposals be examined to see if they're indeed fit for purpose. And this, of course, increases the cost of interconnectors, a cost that's already prohibitively high. Ministers, we're working with UK colleagues to look for a solution, but I've heard very little progress about what the outcome of such meetings, indeed, if there is any progress being made. And I would hope that the Minister could update the Parliament on that sometime in the near future. In closing, Presiding Officer, I want to congratulate Mike Rumbles again on securing the debate and allowing us to debate that and indeed the wider implications of the issue.
And the last of the open speeches is Liam Kerr.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I'm very pleased to be permitted to speak in this debate, and I'm also grateful to Mike Rumbles for securing it. The opening line of the motion is instructive. The concern that has been expressed by communities in proximity to the proposed Blackhillock to Kintore transmission reinforcement regarding visual impact. It is a concern that is easily recognised. The construction of a 40-mile long, 165-foot high corridor of electricity pylons through some of the most iconic and beautiful landscapes in the northeast of Scotland must always be treated with caution and the most intense scrutiny. It might be hard for people from out with the region to understand what an iconic site the Benachie Range actually is, towering over a predominantly flat, rolling agricultural landscape visible from miles around. And the view from the Mithertap is one that draws thousands of visitors every year. It is Scotland at its finest. And so I'm delighted that the recent publication of the National Grid Network's option assessment has recommended that the development does not go ahead, at least in the near future. Yet what is most encouraging to me, as one who values community and local action, is that when it was called upon to act, the community stepped up. This is clearly a victory for people power, and I too would like to welcome the members of the community to the Chamber. Just a few of the hundreds who for many months have been campaigning hard to make sure the proposal didn't get through. I say campaigning hard, that is not the half of it. I can say from personal experience, as I'm sure we all can, that my email inbox left none of us in any doubt of the strength of feeling. And it is they who deserve the credit for the decision. It is they who kept the pressure on the National Grid, on SSE, who flooded the mailboxes and inboxes of us, their elected representatives. The American anthropologist Margaret Mead famously said, "Never doubt that a small group of thoughtful, committed citizens can change the world. Indeed, it's the only thing that ever has." And I think it is important to acknowledge that SSE do seem to have accommodated the calls reiterated in Mr. Rumble's motion for effective community consultation and the importance of incorporating feedback as a means for addressing such concerns. But of course, as Mr. Rumble's made clear, this is not necessarily the end of it. The network options assessment merely makes a recommendation and can be reviewed. The NOAA is an annual process. A recommendation can change year on year as generation and demand scenarios change and transmission development plans evolve. As such, a signal to stop or delay in 1 year might become a recommendation to proceed in later years. It is far from over, and the Kintore route remains SSE's preferred corridor. So the motion is right to highlight possibilities for substantial change and mitigation. Underground and undersea cabling in use across Britain and Europe is more reliable, as Alexander Burnett has detailed, and has less impact on the natural environment. This has been recently recognised by the Welsh Assembly, which only 2 weeks ago, on the 18th of January, unanimously passed a motion calling on National Grid to favour undergrounding when developing new transition programmes in Wales. But I do think Rhoda Grant made important points on this regard, and I hope the Minister will consider those. No one doubts that there is an increasing demand on the electricity delivery network in the northeast of Scotland. Mr. Lockhead, I thought, made very important points that by 2024, a huge amount of additional power will be channeled to Blackhillock for distribution throughout the network. It will come from Shetland, Orkney, the north of Scotland, and the Moray Firth, and it's likely to overwhelm the existing 275 kV line south. A new solution is required. But by supporting this motion today, we are providing a voice to the local communities who simply ask for a more imaginative solution, one that complements and maintains the landscape, one that doesn't threaten the tourist industry and doesn't threaten the quality of life for people in the region. Thank you.
I now call on Paul Wheelhouse to close Mr. Rumble's debate. Around 7 minutes, please, Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And firstly, I'd like to thank the Member for North East Scotland, Mike Rumbles, for raising this motion today. I hope my cold doesn't affect people's ability to understand me. But this motion follows on from the parliamentary questions on the same subject answered by the Minister for Local Government and Housing and myself last week. As the Minister for Business, Innovation and Energy, it would be inappropriate for me, as someone who's involved in the consenting process, to express a view on the proposals themselves for an overhead line that may come before Scottish ministers for determination in the future. But as the Member has outlined in his own opening remarks, it is now in the public domain that the proposals referred to in the motion have been recently reviewed by National Grid under their annual network options assessment, and it has been recommended that the transmission company does not proceed any further in developing its proposals at this time. The Member has asked Parliament to note the motion passed by the Welsh Assembly. Indeed, that's been picked up by other members, Liam Kerr and others, on the 18th of January of this year. I can confirm the Scottish planning policy published in 2014 does, as Mike Rumbles indicated, already state that consideration should be given to underground grid connections where possible. I have noted, however, Mr. Rumbles' point and indeed that of other members present, Mr. Lockhead and Mr. Kerr and others, on this point and will undertake that I will reflect on the points that have been raised. I can make no promises at this point in time, but clearly I will listen to the views that have been expressed today. But Scottish planning policy is clear that international, national and indeed locally designated areas and sites for landscape and nature conservation should be identified and afforded the appropriate level of protection and development plans. Rhoda Grant made very fair points, I thought, in relation to undergrounding and impacts in archaeology and natural heritage, and it is obviously something that has to be taken into account in terms of the process. So for national designations, the policy states development that affects a national park, national scenic area, site of special scientific interest, or a national nature reserve should only be permitted where the objectives of designation and the overall integrity of the area will not be compromised or any significant adverse effects on the qualities for which the area has been designated are clearly outweighed by social, environmental or economic benefits of national importance. Now, I do appreciate a lot it comes down to semantics about language and interpretation, but I want to reassure members that at least is protection in there to prevent unacceptable damage. Our National Planning Framework, MPF 3, identifies high voltage electricity transmission network as a national development. And this means it's vital to meeting our ambitious targets for renewable electricity generation, tackling climate change, and basically just keeping the lights on in terms of energy security. But the design and construction of network infrastructure is the responsibility of the network owners, Scottish and Southern Electricity Networks and Scottish Power Energy Networks. And this is done in conjunction with the system operator National Grid. As electricity network costs are recovered from existing and future electricity bill players, it is the role of the regulator Ofgem to scrutinise and approve network investment plans in order to protect consumer interests. However, having said that, I note the concerns expressed by Mr. Rumbles and indeed other colleagues such as Richard Lockhead, Alexander Burnett and others regarding the degree of community consultation. And I want to reassure members that we very strongly value and indeed expect full commitment to community consultation. Scottish ministers require that any application for electricity infrastructure from transmission companies provides detailed evidence of community consultation, and I expect that consultation to be meaningful. The application must also demonstrate how consultation has informed the applicant's preferred options and clearly explain what mitigation measures they have identified to address the local community concerns. And I will pay heed to such matters in my own deliberations going forward. I do note the points that Mr. Lockhead made very fairly, I think, around where you have a substation of the scale that's proposed, or indeed in other sites across Scotland, taking into account the wider impact of other infrastructure connecting into that. And so I will ask officials to give me some briefing on the sites of that nature, just to look at the points of detail around policy in that respect. But I want to thank the member, Mr. Rumbles, for providing me with an opportunity to outline how Scottish Government policy already supports and protects areas with national designations, to provide an overview of the planning and regulation of electricity networks, and to highlight the importance of the Scottish Government's commitment to involving local communities in decision-making. We do understand that the transmission company had envisaged submitting an application, regardless of whether it's Mr. Rumbles' parliamentary motion or other drivers, in relation to the proposal stated in the motion. This was due to be presented no earlier than 2019. But as National Grid has now indicated that development of these proposals is not optimal at this point, my officials will continue to engage with the network companies to discuss all engineering options, including overhead lines, undergrounding subsea cables, which a number of members have referred to, and I think of a particular interest, and ancillary technologies. And regarding subsea cables themselves, I take on board the point that Rhoda Grant has said. I want to reassure her around our intentions around the islands, communities in particular, that I expect this to be on the agenda at COHI this coming week, a discussion around energy strategy and issues to do with interconnection with the islands has been something that has been a hot topic for engagement with the island authorities and indeed the UK government. But I do take her point around environmental impacts there as well. It's not always a straightforward process, but we obviously look very carefully at the impact of subsea cables being laid. But they do generally provide what is deemed to be a pretty good solution to connecting infrastructure of this kind. I would say this in general to all members, that they may wish to, including Mr. Rumbles, that they may also wish to arrange their own meetings with National Grid. And I can certainly ask my officials, for those who aren't familiar with contacts for National Grid, I appreciate some colleagues probably do have access to that, to give relevant contact details to you, so you'll be able to take forward your own meetings. But I once again thank Mike Rumbles for bringing this important issue to the Chamber today. I want to reassure members that we will always take into account the views of communities in these matters, and I will look to work with members across the Chamber to make sure our policy is always as supportive as we can be of communities' concerns. Thank you very much.
I close this meeting.